Welcome, my friends, to Winsloe United Church on beautiful Prince Edward Island. Thanks so much for tuning in and making us part of your worship experience for this week. Now, folks, we've just come through New Year's, and for some people, this is a time of great reflection, a time where they take a look at their lives, they take stock, see what's happening, and then seek to make changes. Changes so they will be a brand new person, have a brand new life in this brand new year. The trouble is that 80% of these New Year's resolutions to change and be better people, they completely fail and fall apart by the second week of February. And when this happens, people eventually stop trying to change, not just at New Year's, but altogether. So I want to ask you, is it possible to change? Well, now that we're reaching that time of the year when 80% of those New Year's resolutions fail and fall apart, we're going to begin a brand new series called How to Change Your Life. And so, without further ado, let's go praise the Lord. Well, on this beautiful, sunny morning, I want to welcome you, and I want to thank you for coming out and being part of our time here today. Today, we're going to begin a series called How to Change Your Life. It's going to take us 3 weeks. And at New Year's, one of the things that happens is that people go around, they make all kinds of resolutions. I resolve to do this, that, and the other thing. And usually these resolutions are quite good. You know, usually they involve, you know, exercise, you know, eating better, spending more time with the kids, you know, spending more time with your friends and family, making, you know, meaningful time more meaningful. All kinds of things. Exercise more. And the trouble is by about the second week of February, 80% of those resolutions are gone, are broken, thrown in the dustbin of history, never to be recycled. One of the troubles about that is that people begin to get discouraged. They say, look, we tried our very best, we tried to change, and we can't. And what happens is that people stop making resolutions to change their life, stop making resolutions at New Year's, but they stop making resolutions to change ever. And so the question is, can we change? Now, last week we had a sermon about Nathaniel. Nathaniel, he was sitting underneath a fig tree looking out over the landscape. And all of a sudden, he had an encounter with Jesus Christ. And his life was never the same. He would never, ever go back to the quiet peace underneath those fig trees, gazing, you know, out amongst the fields. He would spend his time in fields afar, winning people for Christ. Now, I don't expect anybody like that, you know, to have something like that to happen. You know, because that's only one way to change. But the thing is people can change. And now that we're coming up to the point in time where, you know, 80% of those resolutions have gone, now I want to talk a little bit about how to change. Now, we saw that we can change. This week, next week, and the week after, we're going to speak about how that change can happen. That's what we're going to be talking about. Now, over the last little bit, we've received a few notes, and I wouldn't mind reading them off to you. One is that Isabel Watts had a phone call from Eileen Thorne yesterday, and Eileen asked Isabel to say hello to everybody here in church for her and all those people who are tuning in. And Eileen is in a nursing home in Oaktown, Virginia, in USA. And so, you know, that's a greeting from afar for the people that she knows right here. Also, we received a note. It says, to the members of Winsloe United Church, we would like to sincerely thank you for the gifts of kindness which were given to the patients and clients at Hillsborough Hospital over the Christmas season. It's truly heartwarming to see caring, generous people such as yourselves who make differences in the lives of others. There are many patients with little or no family, and it's comforting to know that there are people out there who take some time to make Christmas a much more meaningful one for them. For the patients and the clients, you have helped to make their Christmas season a very special one. Again, we give our deepest thanks and sincere best wishes for you in this new year. Sincerely, the patients, the staff of Hillsborough Hospital. And you know, I think it was Dr. Seuss in The Grinch That Stole Christmas that said it the best, who said, you know, the Grinch had stolen everything and yet Christmas came. And he said, somehow Christmas means a little bit more. Those people had nothing, and yet they were still able to celebrate because they were together. Well, some people can't be together because of the situations that they're in, and yet they realize that somewhere out there, there's some people who they've never met and may never meet, who thought enough to think of them and provide a little something at Christmas. And what they received, yes, that's a benefit, but the benefit that is the balm for the soul is that someone out there cared enough to do something, cared enough to think about, and then actually do something to help them out. And you know what? That's even during the midst of a pandemic, that is something that each and every one of us can do, and it's something that we have done. And so this is just a little note of the people who say thank you for the work that you have done. And with that, let us begin our morning of worship.
Jesus once said, while I am in the world, I am the light of the world. And Jesus also said that where two or three have gathered together in my name, I am there in their midst. And so, my friends, as we gather today as the people of God, as we gather together right here in the house of God, the Son of God is here. And so, my friends, as the light of Christ begins to shine to dispel our darkness, so let the word of God echo forth for all to hear. As the Spirit of the Lord works with us, we become more and more like him. And then the people of God will say together, amen.
My friends, as we gather in this place, we gather with the light of Christ shining. We gather with the people of Christ by us, and we gather with the hope that the way we are today is not the way that we always will be. Indeed, because of the light of Christ shining within us, it can transform us. And so on this wintry day, let us come as we sing together our hymn, In the Bulb There Is a Flower. Day, my friends, there's many things that this world calls on us to do.
There's friends and family. They call us maybe one place. There is Coronation Street that I'm sure calls some of us to watch. There's all kinds of things that demands a lot of our time. And yet on this day, we have come here. We have come here to be at the house of God, with the people of God, as members of the family of God. And so on this day, as we gather in the house, as we gather as the people, let us gather with the words of faith that have helped to bring us to this place here today, as we say together our creed that we can find on our sheets or on our bullet or on our screens. But let us say together.
We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus, crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God.
And because we know that we are not alone, because we live in this, our God's world, because Jesus Christ came not just as a judge, but as a hope, who has come to reconcile us and make us new. We know that we have a God that we can come to, who is concerned about us, who seeks to plant his Spirit within us, to bring us closer to himself. A God who says, I have seen the life that you've lived, and yes, it may be dinged up a little bit, but the one who can create it anew. Let us come before that God now with our prayer confession, and let us pray. O Lord Jesus, if I've turned my back on someone this day, forgive me. If I have caused someone not to ask for help because of words I have said or things I have done, forgive me. If I have made someone feel worthless, forgive me. Lord, always remind me that you called all people to come to you, and you didn't turn anyone away. You will not turn me away. Amen. And Lord Jesus, I now ask you to hear the confessions of all here who seek you and may truly need you this day. Hear now our secret sins and shames that we can share with nobody else. But on this day, O Lord, we know that we can share with you. Be assured. Be assured that this day the Lord has heard you. Be assured this day that the Lord has forgiven you. Thanks be to God. And amen. Well, my friends, every once in a while, we get, because of YouTube, every once in a while, I'll get an email or a letter from someone who is from afar, who would like to know some answers to some questions that maybe they've come from the sermon or the Bible passage that we've read or something like that. Or maybe it's just been something that's been rattling around in their own lives and has been tapping them on the shoulder. And every once in a while, we received a letter and say, you know, Reverend J.D., could you address this somehow? And so last week and this week, we received a letter from a viewer who is from away, and that person would like to have some answers to some questions. And there were several questions, and they're a bit more involved what does John 3:16 mean? It's a little bit more in depth. Now, the first question that she asked was, you know, do all good people go to heaven, even if they don't, you know, read the Bible or go to church or things like that? And my answer was no. Being good doesn't get you into heaven. pretty much, well, every religion, except for Christianity, says, I'm the teacher, you're the student, do these things, and at the end of the day, if you've done them to a certain level, come on in. But what Christianity says is, no. I have not come for those who are good. I have come for those who will accept the gift. Whatever you do in your life, it cannot be enough. So I have given you this gift of grace. All you have to do is receive it. And once you receive it, then the way is clear. And because of my profession, because of the calling that I've received, I spend a lot of time with people who are dying. And I've been in a lot of deathbeds and people who are in palliative care and people who have, well, are slowly passing from this world. And everyone that I've spoken to have said, J.D., I have regrets. Now, those regrets might be different for different people. But everyone has a certain level of guilt, and everybody has a certain level of regret. No matter how good they are, you know, I might look at them and say, geez, this person is the salt of the earth. And yet, when their mortality is raised to their face, they say, I have regrets. And they can point to one or more incidents that they really wish they could take back or did different, things that they said or didn't say, things that they did or didn't do. I wish I'd spent more time with my kids. I wish I had loved my wife a little bit more. I wish I had told my grandma that I loved her. All these kind of things. And I also liken it to, you know, a politician. You know, they go into the job with the best of intentions. You know, they fill out forms saying all the great things that they did. And yet, once they get in, the other party or other people or, you know, people like Steve Murphy, you know, look and they find, you know, maybe 5, 10, 15, 20 years in the past, maybe they weren't the same person that they are today. And that gets raised up. Can any of us undergo a deep dive, a detailed scrutiny on our lives? I know I can't. And so Jesus says, I'm not coming for the people who are strong enough to turn their life around and do good. I've come for everyone who calls on my name. That's what we answered last week. Now this week, we have two more questions. And the questions are, will we see our loved ones when we get to heaven? And the second one is, will we know each other? So let's look at the first one. Will we see our loved ones again when we get to heaven? And the short answer is yes. Now, there are some religions that say, well, you know, yes, there is life after death, but you know what? You lose your personal consciousness. You lose your sense of individuality. It was an illusion all the way. Anyway, when you die, you're just like a drop that goes back into the ocean. You don't remain a drop. You become part of the great ocean, become part of the all soul, and you're still alive, you're still, you know, part of the universe, but, you know, your entire sense of self, you know, all this that you created your lifetime of doing and being, that's all gone. Well, that's not what Christianity says. And I'm going to look at Thessalonians 4, 16 and 18. 16 through 18. And it says, for the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God. And the dead of Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. Now, do you notice all the references of being together, being with one another? You will be with the people that you've lost. And did you hear the word together? It's there. We will be together, together with one another, together with the Lord, forever. And what that means is that the personal relationships that you make right here and now will go on forever. The love that you have now will not be lost to death. That love will go on. Why, when someone dies, does our heart ache so? Because that loved one is no longer there. And that leaves a tremendous wound in our soul. And this is the final defeat of death. But that's covered over. And that love will continue on. And notice what Paul says here. He says, the dead of Christ will rise. And yes, we believe our souls will go to heaven when we die. But that's not it. That isn't the climactic end of our salvation. At the end of things, we will get new bodies. We'll be raised just like Jesus was. And remember the stories, you know, that happened after Easter. You know, Thomas said, well, you know, if I won't believe until I can poke my finger in here and poke my finger in there. And then, lo and behold, Jesus is there. And he says, come on, Thomas. Poke away. And then later on, Peter is depressed. He's off by himself, off with the disciples, and he's fishing. And then Jesus shows up, and he says, come on, Peter. Broil me a fish. And he broils him a fish, and then these two companions eat together. We will have a body. We will be eating. There will be love. There will be walking, there will be hugs. We're not meant to have an immaterial future where we float around like Casper the Friendly Ghost, no. We're going to walk, we're going to eat, we're going to hug. And this is the final defeat of death, that what we receive is not a consolation prize for the material life that we lost. What we will receive is the restoration of the life that God always intended for us to have. We will get the body, we will get the mind, and then we will get the love that we always longed to have. A body not broken with age or conflict or birth defect. A mind not addled with, you know, Alzheimer's or PTSD or anything like that. Or a love that's the second best kind of love. A love that we know will end because someone has died. No, we will get the love, the mind, and the body that God always intended for us to have. And you see, there's a real you. There's a real you buried deep down inside you. But there's all these flaws and weaknesses that bury and merit. However, there will come a day when the love and the holiness of God will burn all those flaws and imperfections away. And on that day, we're going to see each other and be like the first time. And we'll say, you know what? At your very best, I saw glimpses of that in you. And yet here it is, front and center. I saw glimpses of this, I saw flashes of this, but now look at you. It is here. And that leads us into the next question. Will we recognize one another? And the answer is yes. If our love is going to last, of course we are. That love is going to survive. We'll be able to recognize one another. But there's a but there. And here's what I mean by that. And there's nothing in the Bible that says what I'm about to say, but I always imagined that it'd be like meeting someone on the street that you used to go to high school with, you know, a long time ago, or maybe you were grew up one another, maybe she was the girl next door, but you or her, you know, moved away, and then you meet on the street, or you see her in Tim Hortons or something like that. And you look at her, and you say, "Are you?" And she says, "Yes, I am. Are you?" And you say, "Yes, I am." And then, of course, you know, there's a double-double and, you know, a conversation afterwards. It's like that. And here's what I mean. I talk a lot about my grandmother. But my only memories of her are as an old woman with white hair. She loved to sing, but my heavens, she had a terrible voice. Terrible voice. She'd be in there making bread or making cookies or making a pie. And she'd be in there making and she'd be singing, "Will you love me when I'm mutton as you do, now I am lamb?" And I would say, "Geez Louise, good thing that woman's cooking is so great or I'd be out of here." And she loved to laugh. And we'd be sitting down, we'd be watching Gilligan's Island, and Gilligan would be doing something, and she would laugh and laugh and laugh. And you know what? I would sit there, and I'd watch her, because she was a lot more entertaining than Gilligan's Island. And she'd just sit there, and I'd soak in all that laughter. But when we meet again, she won't be an old woman with gray hair. She will have the body that God always intended for her to have. Not old with age, not ravaged by cancer, but the beautiful body that matched her soul. And when she sings, perhaps I'd be more interested in her singing than the pie that she was making, or pretty close anyway. She will have that beautiful voice, but she will always have that wonderful laugh. She will always have that wonderful laugh. And so will we recognize them? Of course. Not because of the flaws that they had, because we will recognize the love and the gifts that have now been elevated. And of course, she'll look at me and say, "Well, JD, I can tell you, you haven't changed a bit. How can you improve on this?" But my friends, those are the answer to your questions, and I really hope that I answered them in a way that gave you something to think about and something to ponder, and I hope I answered the questions and the sub-questions that are found there within. And I guess the last one I will say is that, you know, what about people who have some kind of mental illness or, you know, maybe never heard of Jesus? You know, they've lived their whole life, say, in, you know, in some isolated community, or maybe they just didn't believe. What happens with them? It is my thought that the love of God is so great that love and provisions have been made. What I preach to you, I preach from the Bible. And that is the assurance that when you believe, you will receive the gift of eternal life. But that gift is always there. It's always there. Does that gift survive beyond death for someone to claim that there afterwards? It is my prayer, my hope, and my belief that it does.
My friends, the good Lord has given us eyes to see, ears to hear, and a mind to understand. He's given us a life and love to share. So on this day, let us give those gifts that only we can give. Our offering will now be accepted.
With his hands, with every
seek to give back to God a small measure of what we received, let us also give back to God the prayer God gave to us to say together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Our word of God comes from the book of Galatians. And in this we're going to be talking about, we're going to be looking at, you know, how we can change, and as we take our first look of how we can change our lives, we're going to take a look at the tools that God uses to change lives, to change your life. And so from the book of Galatians 5:13-26, we hear, "You, my brothers and sisters, were called to be free. But don't use your freedom to indulge the flesh. Rather, serve one another humbly, humbly in love. For the entire law is fulfilled in keeping this one command: love your neighbor as yourself. If you bite and devour each other, watch out, or you will be destroyed by each other. So I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desire of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit, and the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. They are in conflict with each other, so that you are not to do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. The acts of the flesh are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissension, factions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, and faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, let us keep in step with the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking, and envying each other." May God bless to us our reading and our interpretation of this God's holy word. Amen.
Thank you.
Now, when I was a lawyer, there would be times that, well, I meet with clients in places other than my office. If an elderly person, wanted their will done, I'd go see them in their home. If an accident victim was having trouble with the insurance company, I would go see them at the hospital. Also, if my client was behind bars, I'd go see them at jail. Now, I didn't do a whole lot of criminal work, but there were times that previous clients of mine would find themselves in difficulty, and they would call me to represent them. And this is what happened in this particular case. I represented this fellow in a divorce matter, and a few years later, I received a call from him that he was charged with attempted murder of his ex-wife. Apparently, a mistake was made when doing the invitations to a particular Christmas party. They both got invited. And after the Christmas spirits, I don't mean, the religious kind, got involved, fireworks started happening. And that's when I got a call to represent him. Well, after a very long, drawn-out affair, my client was not convicted of attempted murder, but he was convicted of a lesser charge and received a few years in jail. Now, following the sentence, I was again contacted to help him put his affair in order. He wanted to sell his house, transfer the title of his truck, get some outstanding bills looked after, give some money to his mother, and a few other things. Now, given my status as his lawyer and the nature of my visits, I was allowed to meet with him privately. Now, these private meetings, they were in a room, and that room was very barren. All was inside was a lamp up top and two seats. There wasn't even a table to write any notes on. And when the guards came and put me in the room, they would go get him. And this particular time, it was my last time meeting with him. When the guard closed the door, he began to cry. Not just a little sniffles, but big, heart-wrenching, body-shaking sobs. Now, needless to say, I was taken aback by all of this. But when I got him quieted down a bit, I asked him what the problem was, and he says, Mr. Kennedy, I've done a lot of things in my life that have hurt people. He said, I've done a lot of things, many little things, that led up to this moment. I could have stopped them. Anywhere along that line, I could have stopped them by making a different decision. But I didn't. I was happy the way things were going. And now look at me. I'm locked up here. Life is going to go on without me. And there's nothing that I can do to change it at all. My friends, what we do in our life matters. The decisions that we make today shape our present, and the decisions that we make today determine our future. If we spend beyond our means, soon we'll be bankrupt. If we goof around at work, well, we're not going to last at that workplace very long. And then there'll be no positive reference that will follow us on our resume. If we goof around at school or at university, we'll do poorly, and then options will be limited in the future. If you like to party and jump from bed to bed, soon your life will be littered with meaningless, shallow relationships. Not only do the decisions that we make today affect our lives and shape our future, they also shape the present and the future of our children, our friends, and our family. If we choose to spend beyond our means, we're going to pass on that attitude and our money handling skills to our children and ensure that they will have the same problem. If we cat around on our spouse, we'll bring the pain of divorce into their lives, as well as our parents and our friends, and we'll bring the reality of a broken home into our children's lives. If we gossip and don't keep confidence, The person that we talk about will be hurt, devalued, shamed, and other people will not confide in us in the future and make sure we're very lonely. Drinking, it will affect people. Our obesity affects people. It affects the lives of the people who love us, who care about us, and who watch helplessly as we hurt ourselves. Now, we live in a society today, if it feels good, do it. You know, that's even a slogan for a brand of clothing. Yet all around us, we can see broken homes, broken relationships, addictions, depressions, the pain that this kind of living represents. I read to you today our Bible passage from the New International Version. That's the one that I generally use. But there's another version out there. It's called the Message. And what that Message Bible tries to do is take the language and bring it into modern vernacular. So I'm going to see what the Bible says using our Bible passage for today, but using the Message Bible. Our Bible says it this way. It's obvious what kind of life develops out of trying to get your own way all the time. Repetitive, loveless, cheap sex. A stinking accumulation of mental and emotional garbage. Frenzy and joyless grabs for happiness. Trinket gods, magic show religion, paranoid loneliness, cutthroat competition. All-consuming yet never satisfied wants. A brutal tempter. An impotence to love or to be loved. Divided homes and divided lives. Small-minded and lopsided pursuits. The vicious habits of depersonalizing everyone who into a rival. Uncontrolled and uncontrollable addictions. Ugly parodies of community. And I could go on. Do you see any of that in today's world? Written 2,000 years ago. Do we see anything like that today? And I want to ask you, is this the kind of life that you want to lead? Is this the kind of life that you want to bring into your family? Or is there a better way? God says there is. To continue on with the Message Bible, it says, but what happens when we live God's way? He brings gifts into our lives, much the same way that fruit appears in an orchard. Things like affection for others, exuberance about life, serenity. We develop a willingness to stick with things, a sense of compassion in the heart, and a conviction that a basic holiness permeates things and people. We find ourselves involved in loyal commitments, not needing to force our way in life, able to marshal and direct our energies wisely. Now, I'm sure that if I were to call for a show of hands, I'm pretty sure every one of us here would want those qualities in our lives, in our families, and in the lives of our children and grandchildren. And you might be saying, well, geez, JD, I don't know how to do these things, or JD, this is impossible. You can't teach an old dog new tricks, or you know, like my client said, I'm too old to change now. The damage has already been done. But I can tell you that it's not too late to change your life. One of the reasons why I try to use our creed, you know, at least once a month, is because of the words that it says. The faith that we have in God. A God who's a miracle-working God. Who has created, yeah, he created. But you know what? He is still creating. He's still creating in your life. Who has come to reconcile us and make us new. Change us. How does he work? He works in us and others by the Spirit. He didn't come into this world to condemn this world. Not just as a judge, but also as a hope. Can we change? Sure we can. We have a miracle-working God, and the same God who can heal a broken body can heal a broken life and soul. And when you call on God, God will start working a miracle in your life and start changing it. How does God do this? What does God mean when he says, I'll change your life? Now, when I was growing up, I heard a lot of people say, well, you know, J.D., Jesus changed my life. Well, how does he do that? Does he do surgery? You know, is there a brainwashing involved? Is there some kind of magic bolt from out of the clouds and all of a sudden you're different? There's a lot of confusing advice coming out nowadays on how God changes us. Some people say, well, just wait on the Lord. That's the passive approach. Other people say, if it's to be, it's up to me. That's the activist approach. And I have to say that it's probably a bit different for every person. But what I can tell you is that God uses three tools to change your life. We're going to talk about them right now. The first tool that he uses is the Bible. 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17 says, the whole Bible was given to us by inspiration from God, and it's useful to teach us what is true and to make us realize what is wrong in our lives. It straightens us out to help us to do what is right. It is God's way of making us well prepared at every point. The Bible changes our thoughts, and so it changes us. If you want to get serious about change, you need to get into the good book. Read it, study it, memorize it, meditate on it, live it in your life. Try to do the things that it says to do. You maybe say, well, geez, J.D., how can I memorize it? I can't memorize anything. My mind is a sieve. And if you say, like, say that, I'm going to tell you right here and now that you're wrong. How many recipes do you know off by heart? How many times did Erica Kane get married and divorced? How many Stanley Cups did Toronto Maple Leafs win? Half as many as Montreal. How many goals did the Rockets score in his career? 545. You can learn. The more you get into the Word of God into your life, the more the values and wisdoms of God you'll understand, and the more you're going to change. When you face temptation or faced with a decision which will lead, which will affect your present and shape your future, these verses will come to your mind. Now, some people tell me, well, J.D., you know, I'm a lapsed Catholic. Or they'll say, you know, J.D., I don't have any faith. And I ask them, are you reading the Bible? And when they say no, I say, well, what do you expect? The Bible says, faith comes by hearing, and hearing the word of God. The Bible and the way it's presented, whether it's at church or your own reading, is one of the tools that God uses to change your life. You say, well, where do I start? Well, you know what? Every week we have the lighting of the Christ candle and we say a verse. And that verse I tried to use as a theme verse for our message for the day. Maybe you can start there. Or maybe, you know, the Bible Society has all these reading guides about the Bible. Maybe you can start there. The whole idea is to start. The second thing is the Holy Spirit. Remember in the Creed it says he works in us and others by the Spirit? God puts a Spirit in us. And this is where the power comes from to change. Romans 8:11 says, once the Spirit lives within you, he will bring your whole being new strength and vitality. God brings his power into your life. The Holy Spirit is God himself in spirit form. And when you commit your life to God, he comes into your life. 1 Corinthians 3:18 says, as the Spirit of the Lord works with us, we become more and more like him. The verse we said, when the light of Christ began to shine. God's number one purpose in your life is not to make you happy. God's number one purpose in your life is to make you like Jesus. Genesis 1:27 says, when God first formed this world, he said, let us make man in our own image. And he's been doing that ever since. That's not a one-day event. That's a lifetime event. That's his ultimate goal, to change you. God's ideal is to tell us how to change through his word and then give us the power to change through his spirit. You read it, then he empowers you to do it. Unfortunately, we don't always follow the ideal. I know I don't. So God has to use a third way to change us. And when we don't respond to the word or to the Holy Spirit. And that third tool is circumstances. Problems, pressures, headaches, difficulties, stress always get our attention. Many of the people who have heart attacks eventually become the healthiest they've ever been. They start walking several miles a day, they change their diet, they stop drinking and smoking. Their entire life has changed because that heart attack got their attention as to how their lifestyle was affecting them. The same is true for God. Romans 8:28 and 29 says, to those who love God and are called according to his plan, everything happens to fit into a pattern for good. For God chose us to bear the family likeness of his son, Jesus Christ. When our lives go off the rails, God will use the situation, the pain that we're going through, to get our attention, to show us how our lifestyle is affecting us. Where do these problems come from? Did I cause them? Is the devil doing it? Is it from God? Well, really, it doesn't matter where these problems in your life are coming from. No matter what the source is, God can use them to change your life, if you let him. God never ever wastes a hurt. God never wastes a hurt. He will take that hurt and try to work it for the better. All things can fit into a pattern for good, to make us like Jesus. If God is going to make us like Jesus, then he's going to walk with us through some of the very same situations that Jesus went through. There were times when Jesus was lonely. There were times when Jesus was tempted. There were times when Jesus was tempted to be depressed or to get angry or to blow up or to be impatient. And God allowed Jesus to go through all these things. But he walked with Jesus every step of the way. Do you think he's going to spare you from these things that he didn't spare his own son from? He's more interested in your character than your comfort. Hebrews 5:8 says, Jesus learned obedience through suffering. So how do you think we're going to do it? Hebrews 2:10 says, Jesus was made perfect through suffering. How do you think that we're going to do it? How do you think we're going to be made perfect? But you know what? God will walk through us and with us every step of the way. God works first through his word, then the Holy Spirit, then he uses circumstances. For instance, scripture says, be humble. Before honor is humility. You read it in the word and you ask God for the power to get rid of the ego in your life. That's God's ideal way of dealing with things. But if you don't learn to be humble from God's word, the next time you're humiliated because of your ego, perhaps you will remember and learn through a circumstance. These are the tools that God uses in our lives. Proverbs 20:30 says, sometimes it takes a painful situation to make us change our ways. We rarely change until we get desperate. We don't change too often when we see the light. But we often try to change when we feel the heat. God uses that fire to get us moving. Often, we'll put up with lots of things that we know needs to be changed in our lives until it actually becomes uncomfortable. My friends, don't be afraid of God. Christians have no need to fear God in terms of being afraid of him. We're part of his family. If you want to be afraid that you might miss out on all that God has made for you. Take how you live your life seriously, because it touches not just you. It touches so many other people. Take your salvation seriously. It has eternal implications. Nothing is more important than your spiritual growth. Take it seriously. And my friends, God has the power to change your life. God is the energizer for change in your life. He says, I will give you the power to do what you want to do, need to do, and know what is right to do. I empower you and I energize you. God is the energizer to will and to act. He'll give you the willpower and he'll give you the ability. He'll give you the desire and the capability to change. Now, my friends, these are three tools that God uses to work change in your life. But there's also three choices that we need to make them work. And to hear about that, well, you got to come back next week. But until then, all I can say is thanks be to God. And amen. My friends, let's just bow our minds and hearts just for a quick moment in prayer. Lord Jesus, today we have gathered in this place called the House of God. And we feel so fortunate that we can gather here with you as part of the family of God. And Lord, we want to thank you. We want to thank you for all that you've done in our lives. And Lord, we ask that you continue walking with us. Please guide our hearts. Help us to grow into the people that you want us to be, the people that we need to be. Rather than following our own ways, please purify our hearts and to make us more like you. Please guide our paths and help us take steps that will guide us towards your plan for our futures and not our own whims. Lord, you know our hearts. And you know what we struggle with. Each one of us are different, but we all struggle nonetheless. Not everyone here is the same. But the one thing that we have in common is that we need you in our lives, because we can't make these changes alone. We bless your name knowing that you will not fail us nor abandon us. So we will not lose courage or be afraid. We'll not worry because we know that you're in control and you will guide us each step of the way. And so, Lord, we come to you today with the prayer that you taught us to say together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Well, my friends, we've pretty much come to the end of our time here together, and I want to thank you. I want to thank you for tuning up. I want to thank you for coming in and blessing us with your time here today. Because when you're here, truly we do feel blessed. And when you're not, you're missed. And whoever you came to this place here today, whether it be by yourself or with a carload, please know that when you came here, you didn't come alone. And when you leave here, you don't leave alone, for the Spirit of the living God goes with you. It's my prayer for you that wherever you go, whatever you do, whatever situation you might find yourself in, that you're always able to feel the power and the presence and the love of God acting and working in your life because he is there. May you know the peace of God in your hearts. And may you know the love of God in your home and in your family. And now may the grace, the mercy, and the peace of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit abide with each and every one of us this day and forevermore. Amen.
Well, my friends, we've pretty much come to the end of our time here together, and I want to thank you. I want to thank you for tuning in and making us part of your worship experience for this week. Now, folks, one of the tools that God uses to change our lives is our circumstances. Now, we can ignore pleasure and take it for granted, but pain insists on being attended to. God whispers to us in our pleasures, speaks to us in our conscience, but he shouts to us in our pain. It's his megaphone to rouse a deaf world. Now, folks, I don't know what you might be going through right here and now, but maybe, just maybe, this is an indication that you might need to make some changes in your life. So who can you turn to start making these changes? You can turn to God. God says, I'll give you the power to do what you want to do, what you need to do, and know what is right to do. I'll empower you, and I'll energize you. God will give you the will, the power, and the ability to change. He'll give you the desire and the capability to change. And so where can you go to start connecting with God? Well, right here in church. So, if you've never ever been to church before, or if you haven't been to church for a long time, please consider this to be your personal invitation to come right here to Winsloe United Church. Get to know God. Get to know his family. And folks, I realize that there's still a pandemic out there. And so, if you feel safer and more secure staying home, please continue to tune in. And always remember, God loves you, and so do we. And so, my friends, until we meet again, and we shall meet again, stay safe, and may God bless you. Amen.